change this phrase, but on Mount Zion is deliverance.
Amen.
Because we are living in the days of the New Testament. Hallelujah. On Mount Zion is deliverance.
Yes.
So you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Say amen. You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. So Zion is inside of you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Deliverance from any captivity. Deliverance from any sickness. Deliverance from poverty. Deliverance from curses. From any evil is in Zion.
Amen.
Now who is dwelling in Zion? God dwells in Zion. The King dwells in Zion. The Holy Spirit dwells in Zion. Now wherever the King of Kings is, His glory surrounds him.
Yes.
Amen. Surrounds him. Wherever the King of Kings is, there's a place of glory. Somebody say glory.
Glory.
If you want deliverance in your life, you must spend time in the glory of God. And Zion is where the glory of God is. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. There is a way you can release the glory of God into your life this afternoon. And I'll show it to you. There are certain things you can do. There are three steps you can climb to release the glory of God into your life, into your ministry, into your businesses. Hallelujah. And you will see the power of God move in your life. Amen. Now, open your Bibles to Leviticus chapter 9. Leviticus chapter 9. But before I read from Leviticus 9, you all know the story how Israel left Egypt. Amen.
Amen.
And they were wandering in the desert for 40 years. Amen. And at times, Moses would walk up the Mount Sinai. Remember? Listen, something supernatural would happen every time this man would climb the mountain of Sinai. Whenever Moses stepped on the Mount of Sinai, the mountain would start to quake and shake, and smoke would rise, and something looking like fire would appear on the top of the mountain of Sinai. Mm-hmm. If you want to have a cross-reference, it's Exodus 24:17. It says, to the people looking, onlooking people, it looked like a consuming fire. But it wasn't fire. The glory of God looked like a consuming fire. Open your Bible. Exodus 24 and verse 17. Looked like a consuming fire. Somebody say fire.
Fire.
Say fire.
Fire.
Now it was not fire. It just looked like fire. Hello? Uh-huh. It was not the physical fire. It was the glory of God, which from the outside looked like fire. Okay? It's very important. Hallelujah. Now, whenever Aaron or Miriam would step on the mountain, nothing would happen.
Hallelujah.
Whenever the shepherds would go up the mountain, nothing would happen. Zero. It's the same thing with many of us. When you pray, nothing happens. When you fast, nothing happens. Because you're not prepared, you're not ready. Hallelujah. But when Moses would step on the mountain, the whole mountain would shake, because Moses knew the secret of how to trigger the glory of God. Hallelujah. And one day, Moses went up the mountain, not eating for 40 days, spending time in the glory of God. Listen, things which are impossible and natural are possible in the glory of God.
It's impossible
to fast for 40 days. Well, it is when you drink some water. But it's supernatural fast. 40 days, impossible, but possible in the glory of God.
Amen.
After 40 days, Moses was sent down by God. God told Moses, go down. The people are messing up. They're dancing around the golden calf. Moses went down. He was hungry. 40 days fasting. Where did he go after he came down the mountain? McDonald's. Burger King. He ate some fufu, right? Some egusi soup. Some kenke, gari. Okay, no. He was judging the people of Israel. And after he finished the judgment, he goes back into the presence of God. He went back to the tent of meeting. What was in the tent of meeting? The glory of God. After spending some time there with his friend Joshua, he went out and he said, I'm going back. the mount another 40 days. This man was fasting for at least 80 days nonstop. The impossible becomes possible if you're in the glory of God. Every yoke will break if you spend time in the glory of God. This is biblical, and this is also my testimony from my own life. When there were times when it was tough and there was no way out, when you were crying before the presence of, in the presence of God, when tears were running down, you were crying and shouting at God, something would happen. Something would happen. The anointing would grow, and finally the anointing would break the yoke. Hallelujah. As your anointing grows today, your yoke shall break in the name of Jesus. As you spend time in the glory today, the impossible shall become possible. Hallelujah. Amen. So one day, as Moses was in the presence of God, God opened the curtains of heaven. Say, Moses, take a look up here. Moses looked up and he saw something. He saw the tabernacle of God. And God said, this is the real tabernacle. I want you, Moses, to build a replica for me on earth. Amen. So right now, if you read your Bible in Hebrews, the tabernacle is still there in heaven right now. That's where Jesus entered with his own blood. It's still there. Okay. Moses built a replica on earth. Okay. It looked magnificent, but something was missing. Everything was there. Moses moved the furniture. Everything was pretty, and it looked like a wonderful cathedral. But something was, the glory of God wasn't there. Hallelujah. Now open your Bible to Leviticus 9. And now the great day had come. And Moses says in Leviticus and chapter 9, verse 6. And he speaks to Aaron and his sons. Can I have a glass of water, please? Then Moses said, this is what the Lord has commanded you to do. You what?
Do.
Okay, there's something they should do. Hallelujah. This is what the Lord commanded you to do, so that the glory of the Lord may appear to you. Hallelujah. Yeah. Moses said, I know how to trigger the glory of God. Don't tell me, I know already. But now I'm going to share the secret with you, Aaron, and with you, sons of Aaron. And I'm going to tell you three things you must do to bring the glory of God down. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Anybody wants to know what those three things are?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Listen, the glory of God can transform your life. You can bring it down into your living room. It's there. It's possible. The way it's described here. Okay. Jump with me, same chapter, verse 22. Leviticus 9, 22. Mm-hmm. Now here we find a summary of what Aaron actually did. Then Aaron lifted his hands toward the people and blessed them. And having sacrificed, number one, number two, that's the burnt offering, and number three, the fellowship offering or peace offering, he stepped down. Heaven and was open. Hallelujah. Anything could happen from now. Amen. Because the heavens open, you're welcome. Hallelujah. Okay. It's the glory of God, maybe. An offering, burnt offering, fellowship offering, and the heavens open. Amen. Listen, if you bring the sin offering, the burnt offering, and the fellowship offering, the heavens will open over your lives. Hallelujah. So he brought the sacrifices. He stepped down. He was ready for the glory of God to appear. Let's read on. Verse 23. Moses and Aaron then went into the tent of meeting. When they came out, they blessed the people. And the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people. Hallelujah. Now it was no longer just the glory of God on the top of the mountain for Moses. Now it was the glory of God for everybody. Hallelujah. Somebody say for everybody.
For everybody.
Amen. Hallelujah. And the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people. Verse 24. Fire came out from the presence of the Lord. This was a different kind of fire. Hello.
Hi.
The glory fire was not only now came out the real fire and consumed the burnt offering and the fat portions on the altar. And when all the people saw it, They became very quiet and lit a candle. Are you reading your Bibles?
Yes.
Okay, let me read again. And when all the people saw it, they became very quiet and lit a candle.
No, they shouted for joy and felt.
Aha, thank you, madam. God bless you. They shouted! Hallelujah! They were excited! Amen! And they fell their face down worshiping God. And from that point onwards, they were known as the people of God. And they were known as the people in whose midst God himself dwells. Hallelujah. Because now Aaron knew how to bring the glory of God down. Somebody say three things.
Three things.
Okay. Number one is the sin offering. Number two is the burnt offering. Number three is the fellowship or shalom or peace offering. You can also say abundance offering. It's different translations, different Bibles. Okay, now let's go through the three offerings. Number one, sin offering. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Listen, God intended each and every one to be glorious. Point to your neighbor. Say, God wants you to be glorious. Wow. When Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, they were full of glory. They were covered with glory. God wants you to be glorious. But because of sin, the glory is now not measuring up to God's standards. If you have sin in your life, you will never see the glory of God manifest in your life. I don't care if you're a pastor, an elder, a singer, whoever you are. If there is sin off in your life, you are falling short of God's glory. You can say, I'm a pastor, there is grace. Yeah, there is grace if you repent. But if you continue sinning and going to church and pretending you're a good Christian, shame on you. You're a hypocrite. You will never see the glory of God. You can have three titles. You can be professor, doctor, pastor. I don't care. The glory of God will not manifest in your lives. Churches today. People are coming together on Sunday. African churches, German churches, celebrating a social festival. They don't feel the glory of God. You hear about God, but you go to church, you don't meet God. God isn't there. As the Bible says in Revelation, he is knocking at the door. He's outside. He's asking you, please let me in. I want to come back into church. If there is sin in your life today, repent. It's the first step to see the glory of God. Repent. Hallelujah. Thank God there is a sin sacrifice. As John the Baptist was baptizing the people in the Jordan River, one day he saw somebody bypassing. He got all hyped up and excited. Behold, look there. That's the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the whole world. Hallelujah. Amen. My sins were put on Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Your sins were put on Jesus.
Hallelujah.
He became my sin sacrifice. All I have to do today is to trust in him, believe in him, receive that sacrifice, and the door is opening for the glory of God.
Yes.
How many of you have believed Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yeah.
I love Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, wonderful. Now that's the problem. Many Christians stop right there. Oh, I'm saved. I've got the fire insurance. I'm not going to hell. No, I'm saved by grace. All right?
Sure.
Yes, congratulations. But you're very far from the glory of God.
Oh, yes.
Unless you've been to the burnt sacrifice, burnt offering. You must bring the burnt offering.
Hallelujah.
Will cost you a lot. Now, in those days, if, for example, let's say, in those days, you are bringing up a little lamb, okay? And you are expecting some nice lamb chops, lamb curry, I don't know, mutton soup, whatever. Okay? And you are waiting to eat some nice food. As this lamb grows up, you change your mind and you say, okay, I'm going to sacrifice this lamb as a burnt offering. You go to the priest, say, priest, this is my burnt offering. And the priest will ask you, are you really sure? Do you know what it means to bring a burnt offering? Yes, I know. It will mean I'll burn the whole thing, 100%. Do you want that? Yes, sir. And then he'll kill the animal, dissect it, clean it, and he'll burn the whole thing. They go, your lamb chops and your curry, it's all gone. They burn it for God, 100%. For those of you who believe in tithes, I don't believe in tithes, sorry. Oh, no, don't try to assume my sister. There's something coming, hallelujah. I don't believe in tithe. Tithe is good. Tithe in New York, I can tithe, it's not a problem. Tithe is for baby Christians. If you are tithing, say I'm a baby Christian. Get your thumb out of your mouth if you're just tithing. Tithing is for baby Christians. God wants your 100%. And some of you think, okay, if I give 10% to God, then the rest, the 90%, I can do whatever I want. Wrong. God is the Lord over your life, over your money. If He tells you this month, give 50%, you must obey. If He tells you this month, give 20%, you must obey. Never, never is for baby Christians. Hello?
Amen.
Amen. If you are surrendered, the money also belongs to God. That's why many churches fail. Yes, I know some people don't even pay their tithe. Shame on you. It's for baby Christians. But if you surrender your life 100%, if you become radical for Jesus, it won't be 10%, believe me, it'll be more. Because 100% belong to God. He gives you the power to create wealth. Amen.
Yes.
So the question is not how much do I give. If your pastor is not driving a nice car, shame on you. If you're a businessman and you're driving a better car than a pastor, shame on you. Why must pastors and men of God drive bad cars? Why? Because you don't respect them. Sorry. Pastor, I don't know. Maybe I'll be out in a few minutes. No problem. 100%, hallelujah, for Jesus. Why aren't more missionaries out there preaching? Because we are not giving. Why are we still sitting in buildings like this? Why don't we have the best buildings in town? Because some of you invest in your own houses rather than the house of God. The burnt offering is 100% surrender. Apostle Paul says in Romans 12, verse 1, to sacrifice our bodies as living sacrifices. That's pleasing to God. Amen. Your time, your money, your body belongs to God, 100%. Do you have to? No, you don't. If you want to keep the 90%, keep them. It's yours. But you will never see the glory of God. You can be a nice church member, take up your cross and follow me. Let me assure you, as Jesus was carrying his cross, he was not going to McDonald's. He was going to Calvary. Amen. And he says, unless you take up the cross, unless you are willing to go to Calvary with me, unless you are willing to die for me, you will never see the glory of God. You cannot be my disciple. You can be a church member. You can be a tithing church member, but not my disciple. God needs radical Christians in these end times. I don't know if you're reading news. What's happening in Germany? We have a rise of radical Islam. By the way, there is no non-radical Islam. There is not. If you are a Muslim, repent today. If you are here, repent. If you are a Muslim, you must be radical. It's in the Quran. I read the Quran. And we have radical Muslims rising all over Germany, and the church is just watching. And the radical Christians who will rise up and speak up and be bold and confront the spirit of Islam. When? Well, we enjoy life so much. But listen, if you want to see the glory of God, surrender your lives. If you're not suffering persecution, you're doing something wrong. Yes. If you're not facing the enemy, you are going the wrong direction. Hello? If you're not facing enemies, you're going the wrong direction. You're flowing with the flow. Repent. Surrender your lives.
Now some of you say this guy is preaching Old Testament. There is an expert of glory in the New Testament. If you open your Bibles to Acts chapter 7, speaks about Stephen. And we know that Stephen's face was beaming like the face of an angel. Wow. He was full of glory like Moses was full of glory. Now how many of you would like to beam like Stephen today? Just think about your electricity bill. In the evening you sit down in bed, switch the light off, you can read. Because you're beaming. Come on, hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now I want to beam like Stephen. But do you know at which point of his life he was beaming like an angel? He was full of glory. As they were stoning him. You know why he was beaming? Because he had made a decision before they stoned him. I'm going to live and I'm ready to die for Jesus.
Amen.
He surrendered his body as a living sacrifice unto God. And as they stoned him, he was still beaming. And one stone hit him, the second stone, finally he came down and he was still beaming through the stones. Full of glory. You can have salvation, it's free. But grace is free. Glory costs you everything. 100%. You have to give up your own plans, give up your own financial plan, give up your own future plan, give up relationships, give up so many things. Give up your favorite TV show, give up your video game, whatever is your hobby, to seek and find the glory of God. Total surrender. Amen.
Amen.
Number three, the shalom or peace or the fellowship offering. Now this is a free will offering. When you receive the sin sacrifice, when you surrender your life, you are good with God. God is happy, okay? No need for any more sacrifices. But everything changes at the peace offering, at the shalom offering, everything. Because the shalom offering promotes you from a disciple to the level of a friend. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You are no longer just a child of God. Now you become a friend. The fellowship offering was a free will offering. Nobody was forcing you to give anything. Not like in some churches where they pressurize you to give. If you know who you are in Christ, if you know the principles of the Bible, nobody has to pressurize you. You'll be waiting to give. Hallelujah. Amen. And some of you like this, who they forgot to collect the offering. Praise God. Shame on you. Shame. You didn't get it. You're not there yet. Hallelujah. Amen. A free will offering is when you just bring something because you love God. God didn't ask for it. God didn't demand it. To God, I'm so blessed. I love you so much. Here it goes for you. Shalom offering. The word shalom is very big. Actually, it's not shalom, it is shalom. Never mind. It's a technicality. But listen. The word shalom or shalom, it means abundance, peace, no lack. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. If you have a handsome husband, you have healthy children, and they're good in school, and the finances are there, everything is blessed. That is shalom. And you're so blessed, you're so impressed with the love and the goodness of God. Say, God, I'm just so overwhelmed, I want to give you something. That becomes your shalom offering. Everything changes here. Because now you're giving because you love Him. Not because you have to. Not because you have to bring your tithe. The pastor told you, hey, bring your tithe. Here's your tithe.
Oh.
This is different. Very different. This is, God, I love you. I brought you some extra. I paid my tithe long time ago. I'm way over my tithe. No, I want to give you some just to bless your heart, God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God, please, everything changes. You won't be reading your Bible because you have to. Pastor told me, read your Bible at least one chapter a day. No, you'll be reading not because you love Him. Or Pastor told me, I must pray every day, 15 minutes. No, you want to pray 1 hour, 2 hours. You are fellowshipping with Him. You are enjoying His presence. You are now a friend of God.
Amen.
You can enter that place today. And the glory of God will appear in your life.
Amen.
And His will be your will, and your will become His will.
Amen.
There will be unity. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Listen, God was so in love with Moses. Whenever God saw Moses coming, he would say, Gabriel and Michael and Raphael, you guys take over heaven. I'm going down. My friend is coming. We're going to have some coffee. Hallelujah. I like coffee, but if Moses was drinking coffee, believe me, God brewed him a cup of coffee. But Pastor Sean, how can you say that? That's sacrilegious. It's not. It's biblical. If you open your Bibles in the New Testament, after the disciples after Christ was crucified and he rose, the disciples decided to go out fishing, remember? Yeah. Peter went out and the disciples, he joined them, hey, we are back to fishing business, okay? And they fished the whole night, they found nothing, remember the story? In the morning, somebody, a carpenter, advising professional fishermen how to fish, said, not this side, the other side. They tried, the net was full, they brought it back. And as they reached shore, something happened. They realized something. There was fried fish, and there was freshly baked bread. Let me ask you, who prepared the bread and the fish? Who?
Jesus.
Now, who is Jesus? Jesus is God. God frying fish for the disciples. Imagine. God kneading the dough for the disciples. And baking bread. He knew exactly how Peter liked his fish. He knew James. Oh, this fish is for you, James. This one is for you. Okay. Oh, Thomas, oh, you like this one? This is for you. He had all sorted out. God preparing food for his friends. There we go. That's the difference. That's the difference. They had become his friends. They were no longer just disciples.
They were now friends.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you're the friend of God, God will move heaven and earth. And sometimes when I'm all by myself, when I travel, in the hotel, I feel like, oh, I have to kneel down now. Now I have to worship Him. Now. He's calling me and I worship Him. Just for a moment. And I go on with my work. Because we love each other. There's unity. There's love. God knows my favorite taste, my color. He knows everything about me. Hallelujah. He is deeply in love with me. I don't know about you. If God has a billfold, money purse, my picture is in there. If God has a computer, I'm all over his screensaver. It's all there. Because he dearly loves me. We are friends. And you can enter this relationship today. Hallelujah. Now the glory, after some centuries departed from Israel, it was God. The glory departed. Ichabod, God. But centuries and centuries later, the glory of God came back. Listen, there were people who did the same thing I just taught you. Number one, they believed in the sin sacrifice, Jesus Christ. These people. Number two, they surrendered their lives to Jesus. They were ready to bring a sacrifice. And number three, what were they doing? They were bringing the fruit of their lips, voluntarily worshiping God. And what happened? The same that happened in the Old Testament. The heavens opened. And there was a sound of a mighty rushing wind. And something appeared that looked like tongues of fire. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The glory of God. Now, have you ever read in Acts chapter 3? Next day, all the disciples went to the barber shop. No, thank you, madam. You're reading your Bible. Thank you, madam. Pastor's wife, amen. Isn't it? Yes. Thank you, madam. Amen. It doesn't say, does it? But they had fire on their heads. If I put fire on your head, sir, sorry. I mean, this hair will be gone. See, it looked like fire, but it was no physical fire. I'm telling you, it was the glory of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And Moses, I mean, John looked at James, and James looked at Peter, and said, you look so funny, you've got some fire on your head. And he said, look at yourself, you also got some, everybody had fire. Hallelujah. Amen. The glory of God came back. Amen. They were empowered. Listen, it's the same glory that Moses encountered in the burning bush. The fire was burning. But it was not consuming. It was the same fire Moses encountered on the top of the mountain where he went. But it was the glory of God. It's the same fire of Pentecost. It looked like fire, but it wouldn't burn. Amen. Today, you can experience the same fire. and every captivity will be over.
Amen.
Every curse will be broken.
Amen.
Every sickness will go. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But you must enter His glorious presence.
Amen. Happen.
You've not spent time in the glory of God. There's no shaking. You can shout, you can pray, nothing will happen. But when you trigger the glory of God and spend time under the heaviness of God, when you rise, the problems seem very small. When you rise, the difficulties are all gone. You know you are victorious. You know you are soaring like an eagle above all your problems. My question this afternoon is, are you ready and willing to pay the price? Close your eyes. Everybody. Number one, I don't care who you are, if there is sin in your life, you are falling short of God's glory. And as God will forgive your sins this afternoon, you are coming one step closer to His glory. And if you know that you know there is sin in your life and you need forgiveness today, raise your hand, I'm going to pray with you right now. Every eye closed, thank you, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you, dear. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you, sir. Anybody else? God bless you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Let's pray together. Join us. Even if you haven't raised your hand, just join us. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Come on, say it. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I believe. You are the Lamb of God. That takes away my sins. Jesus.
Jesus,
I receive your sacrifice.
Jesus,
I turn away from sin.
I repent.
And Jesus, I will follow you for the rest of my life.
Thank you for hearing my prayer.
And thank you for declaring me righteous. Therefore, I am the righteousness of God.
My sins are forgiven
by the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Be on your feet, everybody, now. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I want you to pray a dangerous prayer. A prayer of surrender. Listen, this is a call for Christians. You are born again, you are spirit-filled. This is for you, okay? If you want to get one step closer to Jesus, if you want God to start using you on another different level, your time, your finances, your relationships, your future, everything to Jesus. Now is your time. I'm inviting you to come out. We're going to pray up here. Come out now. Come. Total surrender. Thank you, man. God bless you. 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 Yes, people are coming. Thank you. Anybody else? That means the rest doesn't want to surrender. Anybody else? You are surrendering your life completely. 100%. It's too radical. It's too hard. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Anybody else? Let's pray. I believe as you pray this prayer from the bottom of your heart, God will start using you in a different way, on a different level. Hallelujah. It is not by mind, it's not by power, it's by my spirit. And it's by your surrender. Hallelujah. The more you surrender all you have, all you are, everybody else will still join us. Thank you, Holy Spirit. If you are ashamed to come out to the front, you'll be ashamed to be a witness out there. Shame on you. Let's pray. Repeat after me. Only the people up here. Say,
Lord Jesus,
I surrender.
My life,
my body,
my finances,
my time,
my relationships,
everything I have,
everything I am,
I surrender it to you.
For whatever,
backward never.
My life
belongs to you.
Take my body
as a living sacrifice.
Use me
like you never used me before.
Wherever you want to use me.
Use me
however you want to use me. Use me whenever you want to use me. Jesus, I am your daughter, your son. Jesus, I am your servant. I am surrendered. Ready to do your will. Now let your glory come. Let my words be happy. Let signs, miracles, and wonders follow me. From today. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Listen. God will start giving you, sending you on a mission. God will start empowering you and using you because you are surrendering. And you will see things you've not seen before. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The lack of glory is not because God doesn't want us to be glorious. The lack of glory today is because we don't surrender. Now you can stay here. I want to invite now all the people. If you need prayers for healing, for deliverance, for anointing, we need something here. Come. We're going to worship God. Maybe you can have some worship music in the background. Yes. And whatever you want from God, now's the time to come and to receive. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Very quickly. I know time is up. Very quickly. Come. Hallelujah. We are going to bring the Shalom offering now. I'm not raising funds. Hallelujah. We're going to bring the Shalom offering by bringing your praises to Him. Hallelujah. Very quickly. Yes. Something silent. Slow, maybe soft. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Just keep coming. Wherever you come. Come. All right. Now, thank you, Holy Spirit. I believe God will touch you. Open your heart and start worshiping Him now. Anything on the piano, the keyboard, maybe? Thank you, Holy Spirit. Now worship Him. Open your heart, open your mouth, and worship Him. Worship Him. Speak to Him. He is good to you.
The God is asked, please.
Worship Him.
The anointed understand.
Worship Him. Everybody worship Him. He will heal you. He will bless you.
The God is asked.
He will anoint you. Worship Him.
Your attention is needed at this stage.
Pray. Everybody pray. Worship Him. Open your mouth and worship Him. You want something from God? Worship Him. You want the glory of God in your life? Worship Him. The 120 people in the upper room, they worship God. Now come on, worship God. Let your voices be heard. Worship God. Open your mouth and worship Him. Worship Him. Jesus, full of grace, full of mercy, full of power, full of beauty, I worship You. Ancient of Days, I worship You. Everybody worship Him. Everybody worship Him. Worship Him, worship Him, worship Him. Lion of Judah, I worship You. El Shaddai, I worship You. King of Kings, I worship You. Worship Him. Everybody worship Him. Worship Him.